Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started here tonight. We've got a full house. This is fantastic. Thank you all for coming for the first lecture in our Sexing Science, Gendering Technology lecture series, Rethinking Sex and Gender in Science, Technology, and Medicine. We've got a great lineup of lecturers this semester on a variety of topics. They're all in one way or another going to help guide us through the thorny issues that arise in the sciences of gender, the role of gender in science, and in technology and medicine. So thank you all for coming out. We've got a really great speaker tonight. Before I introduce the introducer of our speaker, let me just thank a number of co-sponsors of this lecture or this series. So we've got the Gender Studies Program. Thanks especially to Karen Prager and all the people in the Gender Studies Program for that. We've got the Women's Center at the University of Texas at Dallas, and thanks especially to Lauren DeSillis from the Women's Center. The School of Behavioral and Brain Sciences, and special thanks to Bert Moore from the School of Behavioral and Brain Sciences for his help. And we've got Blue Cross Blue Shield of Texas, who's generously co-sponsored this lecture as well. So a lot of great groups participating in this series. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Dr. Karen Prager, who is director of the Gender Studies Program and a member of both the School of Interdisciplinary Studies and the School of Behavioral and Brain Sciences, who's going to tell us about our speaker.
It is such a pleasure to be introducing Lise Eliot. I have to tell you, I didn't find her myself, but I've been really wanting to have a brain scientist like her here for a number of years. And some of my colleagues know I've been asking, do you know anybody? And we finally got someone who filled the bill. I'm very excited. And I don't know if the School of the Gender Studies Program has ever had as many people joining with us to sponsor a speaker, and of course, so much of the effort to pull this speaker series together has been with the Center for Values in Medicine, Science, and Technology. So I'm so appreciative of the Center for focusing their whole lecture series this spring on issues of gender. There are so many questions and so many things to ponder in this area. Lise Eliot, I'm going to tell you about her. She is an associate professor in the Department of Neuroscience at the Chicago Medical School, which I believe is affiliated with Rosalind Franklin University. Okay. She received her PhD in physiology and cellular biophysics from Columbia University. She worked in Eric Kendall's laboratory. She combined electrophysiology and calcium imaging methods to analyze the synaptic mechanisms underlying learning and memory. She was later trained as a postdoctoral fellow with Dan Johnson at Baylor College of Medicine right here in Texas, where her research addressed the mechanisms of calcium influx in hippocampal neurons. She joined the Chicago Medical School faculty in 2002 and currently directs the medical neuroscience course for first-year medical students and the ethics in biomedical research course for first-year PhD students, as well as the interdepartmental PhD program in neuroscience. So they have her extremely busy teaching and doing administration there. Dr. Eliot has published more than 60 works, which include peer-reviewed journal articles, magazines, and two books. And I do want to mention her latest book, which will be on sale, I gather, today, and she will be signing. But I wanted to tell you that she says, we hear a lot about gender and the brain, but hearing it from the media, what I tell my students is the media loves a controversy and the media loves noise. And so the media often makes a lot more noise about gender in the brain than actually exists in our research. And so she has dedicated this book, Pink Brain, Blue Brain, which I'm sure she will tell you more about, to people who actually want to know what's really going on in neuroscience and gender. So without further ado, I present you Dr. Lise Eliot.
Okay, well, while she's getting her slides set up, I just have two more things I wanted to tell you about. In just a minute, the ushers are going to come in with index cards to pass across the rows. We just got too many people in the room for trying to pass the mic around, so that's how we're going to do Q&A. And secondly, I should have mentioned at the get-go, the Center for Values in Medicine, Science, and Technology is housed in, a part of, the School of Arts and Humanities, and of course I need to thank Dean Dennis Kratz for his ongoing support of that. So, looks like she's all set up here. Please enjoy the lecture.
Great. Thank you so much, Matt and Karen and the Center for Values and the Gender Studies Program. It's quite an honor to be here. Thank you for coming out. I know not all of you even have to be here for a course requirement, so that's quite an honor. I'm not going to show cool animated DreamWorks videos. I apologize. I hear that was pretty cool last night. I wish I'd been here. But I hope that I'll keep you awake and interested. I should also mention that I know we have till 9 o'clock, and I have basically an hour's presentation with 20 minutes for questions. I hope that's okay. If I see you all nodding off, I'll skip to the chase. But I have a lot to tell you, and I do, you know, believe in data, and it takes a little time to present real data. So, this is where we're starting from, on the topic of sex difference. There's a very strong current of opinion out there. If you just ask the layman on the street, tell me about the difference between men's brains and women's brains, you'll hear a lot, because there's an enormous amount in the popular literature, this belief in the notion that our brains have a sex. There's a pink brain and a blue brain. And this book is 30 years old, but more recently we have books of this genre. Luann Brizendine is actually a psychiatrist out at UC San Francisco. She's got great credentials. She ought to know better, but she figured where the money was, and it is selling this pop science version of brain sex. And she's wrote a first book called The Female Brain, and then of course had to follow it up with another book called The Male Brain, and I can tell you she sells way more copies of books than I do and appears on more national media. But just to give you a flavor for the kind of thing that she's pitching, this is a quote from her book. "The female brain has tremendous unique aptitudes, outstanding verbal agility, the ability to connect deeply in friendship, a nearly psychic capacity to read faces and tone of voice for emotions and states of mind, and the ability to diffuse conflict. All of this is hardwired into the brains of women. These are the talents women are born with that many men, frankly, are not." So, I am so sorry, guys. But, I mean, it's just really absurd, and in my book, I do a parallel quote, which, imagine if this was applied to the male brain, tremendous ability in math and science, psychic capacity to read an aggressor's state of mind, you know, abilities hardwired into the male brain and not the female. We would be outraged and appalled, and every feminist would be marching in the streets. So, but you can get away with this in this sort of patronizing way. And it's just one of many, and so this is a more entertaining version. More recently, we have this Daniel Amen, who, if you Google him, he comes to the top of the quack list. But actually, I mean, he's on PBS. This guy sells a fortune. I don't know if you've ever seen him. He's got some program. He's an MD program for promoting your life. But really, it all traces back to this monster, which I think has sold over 30 million books worldwide. And John Gray is still a huge industry, even though his place he got his PhD from was never accredited in the first place, and so on. Anyway, so that's kind of where we stand. And that's bad enough. But what troubles me, because I write for parents and teachers, and I'm an educator myself, is how this has infiltrated our educational system. And so this exact same Mars-Venus brain sex theme has been taken up by many writers, actually not even all male. There actually are some female writers that are pitching this same stuff to our teachers. But these two authors have been sort of the main perps, Leonard Sachs, who writes in his first book, Why Gender Matters, came out in 2005, he writes, in girls, emotion is processed in the same area of the brain that processes language. So it's easy for most girls to talk about their emotions. In boys, the brain regions involved in talking are separate from the regions involved in feeling. So of course, boys can't talk about feelings. So he writes this with great authority. He has a little footnote to cite this claim. And the claim is based on one teeny little study with 9 boys and 10 girls. It wasn't looking at emotion at all. It was looking at a feature of brain anatomy. And the data were just a mess. I mean, this is the hugest extrapolation, never replicated anywhere else, but you know, it's a cherry ripe for the picking. And it, you know, seems to make a lot of sense. We all know boys. I've got a 15-year-old son, and I could tell you he hasn't talked about an emotion in about 3 years. So, I mean, we all want to understand that, right? And this explains it so easily. And then we have Michael Gurian, who writes this many books, The Wonder of Boys, The Wonder of Girls. And this book, Boys and Girls Learn Differently. And that phrase, boys and girls learn differently, again, if you just ask any teacher in a classroom, what do you know about gender and learning, chances are they will tell you, oh, well, boys and girls learn very differently. They have different learning styles. That's become sort of a dogma. And you know, I can tell you I've written another paper on this, but there really is no evidence from studies of learning per se that boys and girls use any different circuits to learn math or reading or memorization or anything. But nonetheless, it's become dogma. And Gurian's not a scientist or a physician, but he really likes the brain and he really likes hormones. So he writes things like this: girls have great difficulty learning certain aspects of math because of testosterone. Surges of the hormone, which males receive during adolescence between 5 and 7 times a day, can increase spatial skills. Well, we know there's a big gap in spatial skill performance. I personally think it has more to do with video games, hand-eye coordination skills, Lego play, and so on. But Gurian likes testosterone. And even though the data don't support this at all, he found one paper somewhere that did. So it's basically this idea that there's these hardwired, or as Gurian calls them, nature-based differences. Yes, we know there are sex differences. Psychologists have been studying for decades and decades, and you know, spatial skills, math skills, emotional processing, et cetera, aggression. But this fundamental belief that they are hardwired, this is where I'd like to, you know, challenge the findings. And the really distressing thing to me is that these individuals actually are teaching our teachers. So Sachs has made himself director of the National Association for Single-Sex Public Education. He's using these ideas about sex, these claims about sex difference, to actually advocate for gender segregation, which has taken over, not taken over, but it's had a very fast growth trajectory in our public schools in the last 10 years, based in large measure on these claims about hardwired learning differences between boys and girls. Gurian, too, is on the single-sex bandwagon. I know you've got a lot of schools in Texas, Florida, that are opening these single-gender academies. And so he uses our taxpayer dollars, which is really killing me, to train our school teachers in this, this gender pseudoscience. So that sort of sets up, I think, the urgency of this issue. Oh, and just for fun, here's a sort of a very typical kind of clip. This appeared on CBS Morning Show. My husband actually caught it. He was ironing. He does his own ironing one morning. And he said, Lise, turn on the TV. You're not going to believe this. So I was able to get the link.
And heard that men are from Mars and women from Venus, and now there is evidence that when it comes to brains, size does matter. Our doctor.
Oops, sorry.
Bulls, good morning.
Good morning, Harry.
So there really is a difference?
There appears to be a difference in the size of the brain when you compare men versus women. We're talking about the anatomy here.
Right.
Obviously, male brains tend to be larger because men tend to be larger. But within the brain, mm-hmm. certain structures, certain parts of the anatomy, some are bigger in women, some are bigger than men. So for example, in male brains,
right.
men have 6.5 times more gray matter than women do. Now, gray matter is partly responsible for information processing, so it may explain why, in general, men tend to be better in math. However, women...
Don't tell Larry Summers.
I know.
You'll lose your job for that.
But women have 10 times as much white matter, which is the part of the brain that is partially responsible for connecting these information processing centers.
That's why women are such good multitaskers.
Now, interestingly, Harry, they did not find a difference in the size of the part of the brain that's responsible for controlling a remote or the whining center. So that's still under research.
Now, who whines more?
Not me.
Not you.
Okay, well, we could go on, but I mean, you know, talk about innumeracy, right? 10 times. This was yet another interpretation. Actually, so this is Dr. Jennifer Ashton. I always want to say Aniston. It's not Aniston. I have to, like, do this double talk. Yeah, Jennifer Ashton. She's a gynecologist, but she does the morning show with Harry. So anyway, the numbers that they quote actually come out of a Gurian publication. And I mean, it's just amazing, the pseudoscience, and then how it's automatically linked to these math skills, multitasking. Multitasking, by the way, has never been studied. Or females, as far as I know, don't actually have an advantage in multitasking. The only psychological studies I've ever seen of multitasking have to do with, you know, texting while driving, distracted driving. And I hate to say it, but men are actually better at that than women are. So, not that I would ever text and drive, but anyway, so that's just kind of the typical amusement. So, then we get into the real science. And so this was a study that came out a year ago, December 2013, and it got a lot of press. You may have heard of it. It was a study out of the University of Pennsylvania that was looking at, it's a very fine study. They imaged nearly 1,000 adolescents, or kids between 8 and 22 years of age, and just looked at some structural differences. And really the problem was in the way that the article was communicated. It was communicated by Ruben Gurr, who is somebody who's been studying sex differences for a long time and kind of has gotten a lot of mileage out of it. He's gotten a lot of press. And I think the poor radiologist who actually did the study didn't know what she was getting swept up into, because it turned into a big media firestorm. But anyway, I just wanted to point out, so there's these images that floated around the internet for a week or two showing these starkly different male brains. Of course, the blue is male, in this case orange for female, very different wiring patterns, as if men only have connections within hemispheres and women only have connections that cross hemispheres. This famous connection multitasking. And again, it was linked in the press to multitasking. So males are wired from front to back, few connections between the hemispheres. Females, the fibers crisscross between left and right. These might explain why men are better at learning and performing a single task, like cycling or navigating, whereas women are more equipped for multitasking. but you know, here it is, it's real data, and then this is the interpretation. And this 237 is the number of hits on Google News. So it was in the BBC News, it was in the LA Times, it was in sort of all the major press, this same image. Well, here's the real paper. It was published in PNAS, which has varying degrees of peer review quality, depending on who communicates the article. I just want to skip to the end of the abstract. You know, the data is pretty straightforward analysis of brain structure, specifically looking at white matter. But it's this final conclusion that I think is what helped lead people astray. Our results suggest male brains are structured to facilitate essentially action, whereas female brains are designed to facilitate intuition. You know, this paper didn't look at anything about behavioral differences. In fact, the same cohort of 1,000 kids were studied in behavioral sex differences, every measure of cognitive and emotion processing, and the differences were very, very tiny, and they never tried to link the structural differences to the behavioral differences in those same kids, even though they had the data. They just extrapolated their anatomy to this finding. But what did they really find is that the effects were relatively small, and we'll talk about effect size in a moment, but a 0.2 is considered small. And interestingly, it took them 1,000 subjects to detect this. There was an earlier study using the same method. So this is using a method called diffusion tensor imaging, which is a way to look at diffusion in the brain that allows us to look specifically at the white matter. The white matter are the pathways that connect, the myelinated axons. And so this earlier study had half as many subjects and was not able to detect any gender difference. So if you need that many subjects, it tells you that it's a pretty small difference. And secondly, the biggest problem is they did not correct for brain size difference. Remember Dr. Ashton telling us that male brains are bigger than female brains. I don't know if it was in that clip, but she actually says they're 2% bigger or 3%. That's not even right. They're actually 10% bigger, 10 to 14%. Men are bigger than women. They have bigger heads. They have bigger brains. They have bigger hearts. They have bigger kidneys. They have bigger lungs. Nobody ever gets excited about men having bigger kidneys. But the bigger brain, the bigger brain is, of course, the basis of larger intelligence. So. Okay, so they did not control for brain size, which actually is quite important when you're looking at white matter. Because as another paper that was just published in November with a similarly large population of males and females pointed out, that once you correct for brain size, these wires don't do this anymore. That in other words, you see anybody with a larger brain has greater net intra-hemispheric connections, and people with relatively smaller brains have relatively larger cross-hemispheric connections. It's just more of a function of brain size. So a man with a large brain versus a man with a small brain would look as different as this sex difference does. So that was a fatal flaw in their study, and that many people, including me, pointed out at the time. And then, in addition, they found something quite interesting with age. So they're looking at younger subjects here, about 8 to 10, and these are young adolescents and these are older adolescents. The difference was actually largest in the middle adolescence, which is the age when you see the largest physical difference between boys and girls. Think of a 13-year-old boy or a 13-year-old girl. Girls are halfway through puberty. Boys haven't even started yet. And so we see in other measures I'll show you later, our biggest sex differences at that age. So what they're really probably looking at is more of a maturational difference than a sex difference. So when we talk about sex differences, whether it's in the brain or behavior, we have to talk numbers and not this fake tenfold more white matter in female brains, but actual simple statistics. Calculating effect sizes, looking at the mean score of males minus mean score of females, dividing by standard deviation. And so any of you who've had any statistics are familiar with Cohen's D and this sort of general notion that anything that's on the order of a 0.2 or 2/10 of a standard deviation difference between groups is considered small, 0.5 is considered medium, and 0.8 is considered large. So it's really crucial to keep that in mind, because while brain size may not make much of a difference, effect sizes make a big difference when we're talking about sex. And so while we tend to think of sex differences, we think of something like height. We know that men are about 5 inches taller than women on average. And if you plot the bell curve of male height versus female height, it's a big difference relative to the standard deviation. A D value of 2.6, that's considered a very large sex difference in this physical trait. Now look at most of our psychological sex differences. I use the word empathy in quotes. This is based on meta-analysis of studies that have used one's ability to recognize emotional expression in a photograph or a computer image of another person's face. Here we see a sex difference of about 1/3 of the standard deviation. And the reason I picked that number is because Janet Hyde, who is a psychologist, some of you may be familiar with at University of Wisconsin, has done loads and loads of meta-analyses of sex differences over the years. And she published a paper in 2005 with the very provocative title, The Gender Similarities Hypothesis. And what Janet found, she collected all the meta-analyses that had ever been done to that date on sex difference. So it was almost like a meta-analysis of meta-analyses, looking at millions of participants, and basically grouped them all by effect size and found that the majority, 78% of all the different psychological trait effect sex differences are smaller than this difference. Obviously, tremendous overlap here, statistical difference, but but much more overlap than separation, and only a handful of things actually show these larger sex differences. So rather than Mars, Venus, as others have put it, a more appropriate description would be that men are from North Dakota and women are from South Dakota. So we are different. Usually it takes large groups to pick out the differences. You could never pick a random man and woman and find sex differences in most of these psychological traits. All right, so I got a lot more slides to go, and I probably won't get to all of them, but I do want to sort of frame this whole thing with the message that I hope you'll take away. And so I wrote this book, Pink Brain, Blue Brain. I came up with the title and sold the title to a publisher before I'd really formulate, or before I'd really done my research, and my thesis actually flipped, as I was telling a student today, midway through the writing. I was gonna write this Sachs-Gurian book about boys' brains and girls' brains, explaining to parents why their boys like to run around and their girls like to play with dolls, and I just sort of had this aha moment when the data weren't fitting. And so I flipped my thesis, but we didn't change the title, we just did this little Stroop effect where pink is in blue and blue is in pink to indicate that maybe there really isn't such a thing as a pink brain or a blue brain. So in the book and in the talk, I hope to convince you that sex differences in behavior are real but much more subtle than this Mars-Venus stereotype. And there really is no such thing as a male brain or a female brain. I teach neuroanatomy. We pull brains out of buckets, and we look at the sulci and gyri, and I can tell you that there is no way to know whether that individual is male or female. The structures are all the same, and you know, unless you weigh them all up and separate them that way. And hopefully, you who are studying science in a critical way, the Center for Values in Science, understand that there's a lot of lousy data out there. And you know, I never believe anything if I've only seen it in one study, and maybe five or six I'll start to believe it. But the best method is systematic review, statistical review involving meta-analysis. So when you hear about a difference, you should really wonder if it's ever been meta-analyzed. I'm not going to take the time to present the evidence. I certainly am not a denier. There are people who work in the field of sex difference or critique the sex difference literature who don't believe genes or hormones have any influence on our brains or behavior. I'm not in that camp. I think there are effects. I think the evidence is pretty clear that testosterone is biasing. Prenatal testosterone biases a couple of behaviors. In particular, activity level is one of them, and perhaps later sexual preference is shaped. It's not absolutely determined, but I think it might be tilted, and that's based on some clinical populations that I don't have time to get into. But overall, and even when it comes to things like sexuality, I believe that learning and plasticity are a much greater determinant, and many factors we don't even know, but that shape individuals as they develop from in utero on are our various social and cognitive sex differences. So I hope to present the evidence to convince you of that. And to take away that if we actually understood how sex/gender develops, we might do a better job of bridging some of the gaps, which, you know, in the realm of education are troubling. We have a pretty big gap in college graduation by males and females. We obviously have earning gaps. We have family domestic chore gaps. We have a lot of gaps we need to work on. And I think if we would understand these better, we could help minimize them. So let me give you a little bit of framing on how the brain develops so that you can maybe start thinking about this as it applies to gender. So this is just brain development in utero. And of course, like all development, the brain is growing up as a blend of nature and nurture. In the field of neuroscience, we like the nurture side. It's fascinating, it's interesting, it applies to learning, it applies to memory. And so there's been a lot of research that have identified the rules by which experience alters the brain. We've adopted this term plasticity. You know, plastic can be made into milk jugs and playground equipment and so on. And the rules are, if you have two neurons that are synaptically connected, that cells that fire together wire together. So when there's electrical communication, if there's activity in this pathway, if this is the pathway for perceiving a Russian phoneme that maybe you wouldn't hear in English, and you hear that Russian over and over, you will actually strengthen the connections. You'll actually sprout additional connections. And forever onward, this will be a faster, more efficient circuit. On the other hand, if you don't hear Russian when you're growing up, and then you try to pick it up in grad school, there's this use it or lose it phenomenon. And so sadly, we do prune away synapses. It's a very normal part of development, the pruning process, that lessen the efficacy of some connections. And all of this plasticity is basically an order of magnitude or more potent in childhood. This is the brain's mechanism. This is evolution's mechanism of adapting a child's brain to the culture and environment at hand. So how do we know this? Best evidence comes from studies of the visual system back here in your occipital lobe. I mean, who would think vision is plastic? You know, why not just, you know, open the eyes at birth and boom, get a perfect image of the world in the occipital lobe? But it doesn't work that way. Our visual systems require vision to develop properly. So back here in the visual cortex, we know from research beginning in the 50s, actually, that Torsten Hubel and David Wiesel won the Nobel Prize for, that the visual cortex normally has this zebra stripe pattern reflecting input from each of the two eyes, black stripe, white stripe, reflecting input from the left and right eye, which converge on either hemisphere. In an animal, in this case a monkey, who was raised with one eye closed at birth and then opened several months later, from then forward, because of the visual deprivation during early life, those black stripes never form. The eye that was closed never gets input to the cortex. It sort of gets cut off. And as a result, that eye remains functionally blind. And this is really important for children. Same rules apply to human development. Children born with a visual problem, the most common being crossed eyes, they tend to squint. If you have a weak eye, you get double vision, and it's very disconcerting, so you tend to squint that weak eye. And as a result, you're doing what these monkeys did. You're depriving your brain of vision, and that's why a visual problem in a child is rather urgent. We need to get them treated. You need to patch the strong eye. There's all kinds of treatments, but the same visual problem, if it happens in an adult, like if an adult suffers from a cataract, you can have a cataract for 10 years and then have it removed in an artificial lens, and your vision's right back to where it was. Not true in children. There's this critical period for visual development. Babies have to have good vision, or they will forever have a severe visual deficit. And that period, that critical period, corresponds to a phase in development in which we know there's these extra synapses in the brain. This is just looking in the visual cortex. There's almost a doubling of the number of synapses. And then we go through this pruning period. And by the end of the pruning period, the plasticity is largely over for the visual system. So the visual system develops rather quickly, reaching its adult level of synapses about 8 years of age. Luckily, other parts of the brain are a little more forgiving. The frontal lobe of the brain develops, so this corresponds to what we know clinically is the most sensitive phase in visual development, and the end of the critical periods when the number of synapses reaches its adult level. The frontal lobe is a little more forgiving, a little slower to develop. This is where we do our more sophisticated reasoning. Reaches its peak number of synapses about 4 years of age, and the pruning period doesn't really end until the very end of adolescence. And so our higher reasoning skills, memory, language, you know, all that fancy processing we do with our frontal lobes has more time to adapt to its environment. So we know that the frontal lobe pruning, probably parietal as well, or temporal, where we do language, that pruning actually corresponds to the critical period for language. So as I was saying before, you know, and we all know intuitively that if you're immersed in a language before 4 or 5 years of age, it's effortless to pick that up. As you progress through childhood, it gets more and more challenging, and then by the time you're past puberty, you really have to kind of concentrate to learn a foreign language. And that reflects the fact that we have probably a very similar sort of pruning process as we saw in the visual cortex going on in these frontal and temporal areas. So what about gender? Is there a critical period for gender development? We really don't know for sure. We do know that from the handful of children who have been reared in a gender opposite their biology, and this isn't some freaky experiment we do. There are children who have congenital problems, malformations, or other issues, or maybe you're familiar with the David Reimer case, who had this little poor baby who had his penis accidentally amputated during circumcision. Became a very famous case, and they raised him as a girl. And the reason it became famous is because that was an unsuccessful case. He never was happy being a girl. But David Reimer was not switched to a female identity until he was almost 2 years of age. Another case that hasn't been so famous was a child who suffered the same amputation at 2 months of age, a genetic male raised as a girl. From that point forward, I think by 8 months, they had switched her identity. And she grew up and was happy with her female identity. So, and there are other studies, too, of genetic males raised as females because of a birth defect affecting the lower abdomen. And the majority of those girls are happy with their female identity, even though they grew up with XY chromosomes and hormones throughout life. So, not that we want to switch children's gender, but there is plasticity there, especially starting early life. Well, even if we're not, hopefully we're not, you know, switching kids' sex, but what's going on with all this other stuff that is entraining boys and girls in really different ways? If you think of the way boys and girls spend their time, if you think of the way we interact with them, how much are we hardwiring their brains through this learning as opposed to a genetic hormonal mechanism? So, okay, so store that notion of the plasticity contributing to gender, and let me give you a snapshot of where I think sex differences in the brain research stand today. So what is known, this is a rat brain, it's not a human brain. There are psychological differences that are reliable. So there's got to be something different about men and women's brains. I mean, we don't think out of thin air. But it's been very hard to identify these differences, probably because the sex differences in behavior are relatively small. In animals, where most of the research has been done, lots of sex differences have been identified, but these are primarily in the hypothalamus, the part of the brain that controls our reproductive system. So it's kind of stands to reason, and that's where you see the highest density of receptors for estrogen and testosterone. When it comes to the cortex, cerebral cortex, which in rats is quite small, in us, you know, takes up a much bigger proportion of our brain, there's an argument to be made that the human brain really is more of an intersex organ. And just like you can transplant hearts and kidneys between males and females, you know, if we ever get to brain transplants, we might be able to pull it off between genders. So let's see what the differences really are. This is a large study, several hundred adolescents who, just structural brain imaging, just resting MRI, looking at volumes of different structures, and you see that the key thing here is, obviously, boys have larger brains than girls. It's true from birth through death. It's about a 10% difference. And the other thing you see is that this inflection point, remember that pruning process that kicks in mid-adolescence, happens, this inflection point happens earlier in girls than boys. You especially see it for the gray matter. So all of that really parallels physical development. Boys are bigger, and they develop more slowly over a longer period than girls do. But what about individual structures? I mean, we know the hippocampus is important for memory. The amygdala is important for emotion. These are things that there are behavioral sex differences. Are there differences in those structures? Well, once you correct for overall brain size, once you take account of that individual 10% difference, we find, and this is a large study done out of Norway, it was actually a meta-analysis of seven imaging studies put together, so 1,100 subjects. Each of these structures, hippocampus, the caudate nucleus, cerebellum, etc., you can't see the red and the blue dots because they're completely overlapping. There is no difference, or they're just minute statistical differences between males and females. I did my own meta-analysis with the help of a bunch of medical students. We collected every study that had reported the volume of the hippocampus, as I said, part of the brain important for memory. Females outperform males on certain memory tasks. On the other hand, the hippocampus is also involved in spatial skills. So you might predict the hippocampus is larger in men. We could kind of go either way with this hypothesis. But we found, you know, some scatter. So meta-analysis, anything to the right, is it was larger in males. Anything to the left, larger in females. And you see, on average, no significant difference between males and females for either left or right hippocampal volume once we correct for overall brain size. In just the uncorrected brain, the male hippocampus is about a half a standard deviation bigger than the female, just like the brain. All right, here's another myth, this idea kind of from this multitasking notion that men use one or the other hemisphere at a time, but we women, we're better connected, we use the whole thing. Oh, by the way, this is from one of these websites that encourages you to send your daughter to an all-girls school because, of course, her brain is different. So here's a large study. It's not a meta-analysis, but there's 300 subjects, and they did actually have a statistically significant difference. This is looking at just resting activity, so it's not structural MRI, it's functional MRI, but just lying in the scanner, which of your hemispheres is more active? And you see that both of males and females are left dominant. We're shifted over. Males are a little more left dominant than females are. But if females were not lateralized, we would peak over here. We don't. We peak over here. So we're all left hemisphere dominant. Males a little more than females. And this is actually supported by decades of neuropsychological research that find very small and only population level sex. So you really need hundreds or thousands of subjects to pull it apart. And ultimately, gender accounts for at most maybe 2% of the difference in hemispheric lateralization. Here's another version of that. This was the idea that specifically language, that which most of us we think of as processed in the left hemisphere, was thought to be more left dominant in males than females. And this generated from a high-profile paper published in Nature in 1995 out of Yale. And they had, even though they had only 19 males and 19 females, well, this is the early days of imaging. Those studies were hard to do. 19 males and 19 females, they gave them three different language tasks. And in only one of the language tasks did they see a sex difference. But that blew up into this big claim about sex differences, basically this idea that women tend to use both our left and our right hemispheres for language tasks, whereas men tend to use just the left hemisphere. That was the idea. This paper is still cited today. Last time I checked, 1,242 citations. But it's been repeated dozens of times now. People have done language lateralization studies with male and female subjects, and of those that have bothered to report by gender, there is a meta-analysis, no difference in lateralization between males and females. This is published in 2008, and it has been cited only 100 times. So, you know, anybody wants to talk about sex differences, cite that Shaywitz paper from 95 and ignore all the other data that's come along. And it is, even in textbooks today, they continue to cite the old stuff and not refer to the summary meta-analysis data, some finding more lateralization in males, some finding more in females with no overall difference. So this really gives you the picture. There are differences. They're very small. They're statistical. They look a lot like those curves from Janet Hyde's study that, you know, these overlapping bell curves, if with enough subjects you can see. And in this case, 1,400 subjects. This is a little bit different type of functional imaging looking at connectivity. So what you do with this is you image somebody's brain and you find an area of the brain that's active, and then you ask what other parts of the brain are active at the same moment. It's like a cross-correlational analysis. And you find in that case that there are some sex differences. Pink areas where women are a little more, where women are more connected than men. Blue areas where men are more connected than women. So kind of defeats that idea that women are more connected globally. We each have our pink and blue spots. But if you look within one of those spots, you see that on a population level, the differences really are pretty subtle. You can pull them out statistically, but there's much more overlap than difference in any of these sites. And interestingly, another study looking at younger subjects found no sex difference. So same exact analysis of connectivity, and there was no difference in this case between males and females. Now, these are children or adolescents, and so one question I always ask is, if you see a sex difference in an adult brain, and of course there's got to be sex differences, because remember, we've got all these behavioral differences, but if you see this difference, how do you know that it's a product of nature or nurture? Because the assumption often is, well, it's in the brain, it's a biological difference. If we see it in the brain, therefore it must be hardwired. And so I would like to challenge you with a little thought experiment. Consider two subjects lying in the scanner, subject X, subject Y. They are asked to perform a task of moral self-judgment. So they're given this scenario of about a behavior and asked to decide if they acted morally or immorally, and wow, subject X, big response in the medial prefrontal cortex. Yow, you know, there's something going on there. This other subject Y, tiny little blip on the orbital, on the frontal pole, not really too worried about moral transgression. Well, of course, I'm misleading you to think that this might be, say, a female and a male. In fact, in this study, the individuals only differed in the religion in which they were reared. So the top subject was reared as a Christian, the bottom as a non-believer, and you see this difference in brain activation. So I would argue that gender learning, when you really add all the pink and blue experience together and the playgrounds and the drama and the cafeteria, that kind of gender learning is at least as potent as something like religious learning in shaping the way our brains are active. So I hope that would be another take-home message for you. And when you see a sex difference in the brain, ask yourself, what did those people do for the last 25, 30 years before they got into that scanner that made their brains work differently? And unfortunately, neuroscientists do this rarely in their papers. When neuroscientists see a sex difference, they tend to say, is this evolution? Is this hormones? Is this genes? And they don't think beyond those causes. All right, so I'm not the only one to make this critique. Rebecca Jordan Young in her book Brainstorm, and especially Cordelia Fine in Delusions of Gender, she's got the winner title, have critiqued some of this science as well. Rebecca Jordan Young goes really strong against the testosterone brain wiring idea, and I think she's correct to a degree, but I think she goes a little too far, but that's where the only place we disagree. Okay, so I just want to then add a few thoughts about the nurture side and what is shaping children's brain development. And I'm sure many of you have thought about these issues before, but I wanted to throw some findings at you. When it comes to boys and girls, there's no such thing as a gender-neutral environment. Every parent today will tell you, I raised my son and daughter exactly the same, and look how different they turned out. Oh my God, it's all hardwired. But, you know, we're deluding ourselves. It's like there is no such thing as gender neutral rearing. Just like, remember that old Saturday Night Live skit with Pat at the coffee machine? Nobody, you don't know if Pat is male or female, and how the heck do you talk to this person, you know? Of course we talk differently, we treat our sons and daughters differently. We can't help it. You can't interact with somebody without knowledge of their gender. And so this is the more, really what's going on in the background. You have these little blank slate babies, but in the back of your mind, my little football player, my little, Britney Spears, I don't know. But somebody's probably hoping for that, I don't know. Anyway, there is data that link cultural influences to the sex differences in all of these, and I'm not going to take the time to go through all of them, but I try to present that evidence in my book. Just to give you a flavor for it, motor skills. There actually are no differences in gross motor development in the first year of life. We start to see differences in speed and strength after 1 year of age, or more like at 4 or 5 years of age. But this was a study done at NYU. Moms brought their, of course it's always mothers who are the parent involved, bring their 11-month-old children into the lab. And the moms were asked to adjust the slope of this ramp. This is for real. The ramp could go this steep. What's the steepest slope you think your baby will crawl down? These babies wouldn't walk yet. They were only at the crawling stage. And so it turned out that mothers of daughters set the slope more shallow. than mothers of sons, even though once they were actually tested, there was no difference. The girls actually did a little better, but it wasn't significantly different. So, and the same thing's been found out on the playgrounds. We tend to caution our daughters more than our sons. If a kid comes into the emergency room with a with a laceration, you know, if it's a daughter and it's her face, you know, they're calling in the plastic surgeons, and you know, if it's a son, it's, oh, it's going to give him character, you know. So we have very different physical expectations, and I'm sure it influences their physical development. This was in the Times a year ago. Maybe you saw this. Google is great, right? I mean, I don't even know how many billions or millions of Google searches they included in this study, but if you just ask, if you can access the Google searches and say, what are parents Googling? They are 2.5 times, I think, more likely to ask, is my son gifted than is my daughter gifted? What do you think they like to ask about their daughters? Is she pretty? Yeah. No, actually, is my daughter overweight? Yeah. That's, I mean, I'm sure ugly. They ask, is my daughter ugly, much more than my son. And then the weight thing is about 2.5 times or 2 times more. All right. So these are the expectations we have from birth. Brilliant boys or big boys and beautiful daughters. Here's some coloring books, beautiful, brilliant. Why do crayons have to be in 2 different sets? I don't know, everything comes in 2 sets. You know, this is really just a laboratory for gender differentiation. And the thing is, there's good toys and bad toys on both sides of the aisle, right? I mean, the baby dolls and nurturing toys, wonderful skill for pushing babies in strollers, for boys and girls. Similarly, the building toys are excellent for developing spatial skills, the Legos, Duplos. But then we have the war toys and we have the beauty toys, which is, in my mind, not doing anybody any good. But it really, you know, there's no crossing this line if you're 3 years old or older, or buying a gift for a 3-year-old or older. And it's really a shame because in the old days, I do remember the free to be you or me era, and when Legos were first born in the, I guess, 60s, 70s, it was actually, there was no gender to it. It had, you know, only primary colors. And now, of course, Legos became a boy toy once Star Wars and Bionicles. And now, to get girls into Legos, we have to have special Legos with girl themes and tall, skinny dolls. and this is my favorite. If you want to get your kid into science, right? You want to get him a toy microscope. Well, you have to choose black or pink. And then of course the black telescope is a 500x and the pink telescope's a 90x. So, all right. Okay. So, but parents will say, well, I'm just buying them what they want. You know, these toy differences only emerge because this is what children crave. The girls crave the dolls, the boys crave the trucks. But you know what, it turns out, at least for the color thing, and I'll show you the toy thing in a moment, it's not the case. Now, granted, this is one study, and I'm not aware of other studies that have been done, but with the toys there have been multiple, that if you just do a looking preference in infants in this study, you found no difference between boys and girls at 1 year of age. It's only a bit later that girls show this preference for pink and boys show this aversion, really, for pink. But for toy preference, there's been lots of studies. I'm just showing you one. And I like this one because it studies the same children over at 3 different ages. And every study that's been looked at before 1 year of age shows that both boys and girls prefer dolls over trucks. I know this is kind of a complicated graph, but so the blue line is boys and the pink line is girls. And so boys have a small preference, girls have a larger preference, but then it explodes. And when it explodes is age 3, when this is the age of gender identity, when boys and girls figure out they're boys and girls. Between 2.5 and 3 years of age, this is when children figure it out. And once they know what they are, that's when the pink frilly dress phase starts. That's when they have to have these things that conform to the gender. But what's interesting here is you see boys have this strict aversion, you know, they can't go near anything girly. But girls in our culture, or that, this was done in Sweden, maybe even more in Sweden, don't show this. They are willing to play with boy things, sports, building, etc., if they're given a choice. And of course, that's because what do we tell our daughters? You can be anything, right? And we actually mean it. And sometimes we say to our sons, you can be anything, but we don't really mean it. We don't really want them to be a nurse or a teacher or whatever, right? I would love if my boys were either of those, but anyway, in society doesn't reinforce those things. And so you see boys show these aversions, girls do not by 5 years of age. Here's another claim that boys are innately less social. And I have to just educate you about this study because it's cited over and over. I should have checked how many times it's been cited, but it's this, there's a, and this is all in all the Gurian and Sachs books, and Luann Brizendine will tell you that from birth, girls and boys have different social preferences, that girls are more hardwired for faces. And this is the one study that is cited to back that up, because earlier studies didn't find it was true, but they ignored the earlier studies. This is one study done out of Simon Baron Cohen's lab in Cambridge. For those of you who don't know him, he's an autism researcher. He's not Borat, that is his cousin who plays in what are the other movies? That's Sacha Baron Cohen. So Jennifer Connellan was a grad student, and she did this study. She got parents in the newborn nursery to agree to let her come into their hospital rooms and videotape their babies as they looked either at one of two stimuli. First, they had a chance to look at her face standing over the bassinet, or they had a chance to look at this crazy mobile, which was visually correct. It was constructed from a photograph of her face, so it had all the same color and luminosity and contrast. So that was a reasonable comparison. It wasn't actually a choice experiment, which is how Gurian and Sachs often describe it. But nonetheless, they measured how many seconds babies fixated on this or this, and they did indeed find a sex difference. There was a tiny difference where girls spent more seconds staring at the face, and newborn, these are brand new babies, first day of life, and boys spent longer looking at this crazy monster mobile, which had a little ball attached to it. But, you know, these were quite small differences, and furthermore, there's a lot of problems with this study. First of all, there's been other studies. This has been critiqued by Elizabeth Spelke at Harvard, if any of you know her work. Prior studies that found no sex difference in face or object perception, never cited by this group. So this was the only study to find the sex difference. And furthermore, what a lousy experiment. Think of a graduate student talking about bias in science. She knows her hypothesis. She was not always blind to the sex of the babies, and she's staring at the babies making eye contact. I mean, you know, come on. I've written to them saying, why don't you just use a photograph and compare that, but they haven't dared to replicate the experiment in all these years. Nonetheless, this is cited all over the place, so look at how Luann Brizendine uses this study. Anyone who's ever raised boys and girls and watched them grow up can see they develop differently, especially baby girls will connect emotionally in ways that baby boys don't. And girls, not boys, come out wired for mutual gazing. Girls do not experience the testosterone surge that shrinks the centers for communication, observation, and processing of emotion. I mean, it all sounds so reasonable. There's just not a shred of data that supports it. Although she did cite that Connellan study for this claim. All right, so there are differences, though, that do emerge early, and this is one. There is a sex difference in language, and again, this is something parents will perceive. Unfortunately, it's something that pediatricians will note, and so if a boy is a late talker, sometimes they'll write it off and say, oh, don't worry, he's a boy. But the actual difference is quite small. It's about a month. Girls talk about a month earlier than boys. So this is plotting the spoken vocabulary of about 2,000 toddlers, study done out of University of San Diego, and you see that girls are about a month ahead, with this being the normal range, the tan being the normal range. And other very large studies involving thousands of children found basically about a 2/10 of a standard deviation different in verbal development in girls over boys in early childhood. similar, and you put this together in behavioral genetics, you see that sex or gender accounts for maybe 3% of the variance in children's language. So if a boy is not talking, that's no excuse. You know, if a child needs speech therapy, you know, let's not deprive him of that because he's a boy. Here's another early difference, physical aggression. Of course, males are more aggressive than females in every society. We know that. But what's kind of interesting is to look at how this develops. So this is a study that asks parents, again, I think there were a couple thousand toddlers or children in this study, and parents were asked to report whether their child has hit, bitten, or kicked another child. And so you'll see that most two-year-olds are, or many two-year-olds are aggressive. I guess it's not quite a majority, but 47% of boys and 39% of girls will hit, bite, or kick another child. Children are selfish and naturally aggressive. But what's interesting is that they learn, of course. They socialize, they get civilized before we send them to real school. The thing is, girls are learning faster than boys. And when you think of what's valued in society, you know, who gets, how is aggression valued for males or females? I think there's a lot of cues that make it harder for boys to learn that aggression isn't good. When you turn on football every Sunday, you're kind of counteracting that message a little bit. And girls learn it faster. All right, and finally, empathy. So I already told you there is a sex difference in empathy. Simon Baron-Cohen has blown this up into this essential difference. There is this absolutely fundamental sex difference between us. Women are by nature empathetic, and men are hardwired for understanding and building systems, kind of a long, complicated way of saying to be scientists, which is a little challenging for women going into science to hear that. In fact, if you look at meta-analyses of sex difference in empathy, it's on the moderate side in adults, but in children, it's quite small. There's very little difference between boys and girls in their sensitivity to other people's emotion. And if there's any difference at all, it's probably maturational, that girls are a little bit ahead in their verbal skills and so on. So this is largely a learned difference. Now, the problem is Simon Baron-Cohen doesn't use objective tests of measure of empathy. He uses subjective surveys. And so his favorite survey to test empathy is to ask people to agree or disagree with statements such as, I really enjoy caring for other people, or when I was a child, I enjoyed cutting up worms to see what would happen. Gee, I wonder who's going to answer strongly agree or strongly disagree to these statements by the time they're adults. So if we actually look at, as I mentioned, the difference in adults is on the subtle side. If you do objective measures, just, you know, rapidly identifying facial emotion, there's very little difference between males and females. And this was a brain imaging study done during just such a task, and there was no difference in brain activation during measures. And again, this is meta-analysis. So I'm run into time where I should give you a moment for questions, so I'm just going to do a real quick run through implicit bias. I won't do it its justice. For those of you who aren't familiar with implicit bias, I'll show you the website to go to. But there's no question that So here's the thing, the common complaint against, sex difference, people like me are considered sex difference deniers because of the fact that women have had equal opportunity for a long time now, and if we're not going into engineering, and we're not going into computer science, and we're not applying to be leader of the company, that's because it's just we're more nurturing by nature. It's not part of our natural drive. Well, the counter argument to that is we have bias, and of course explicit bias is dead, but there's quite a lot of evidence for implicit bias. So in the realm of science, this was a study that came out a couple years ago now. Maybe you've seen it. Researchers at Yale constructed a resume of a hypothetical recent college graduate with a degree in biology, and they sent this resume around to science faculty at major research universities and said, would you hire this individual to be your lab manager? And they tricked the faculty by telling them they're developing a mentoring program and would they be interested in being a mentor to this student. So of course it was one resume and some of the faculty got Jennifer's name on the resume and some of the faculty got John's name on the resume. And by and large, John got the job 60% of the time, Jennifer 45% of the time, and the starting salary for this kid right out of college was about $30,000 for John and $26,000 for Jennifer. Identical resumes, right? And this is in 2012. And these are by faculty who, men and women faculty responded the same. There was no difference between male professors and female professors. We're all biased. This is entrepreneurial pitches. This was a study done by economists. They had a hypothetical product that they were trying to sell. They had either a male or a female in a video pitching the product. And some of the pitches were, I think they were all video pitches. And they found a consistent gender gap where, you know, the investor would rather put money into the same product when it was pitched by a man than by a woman. But there's an interesting twist to this. They had to be attractive. So the real data are that overall, these are males, these are females. Yes, people will buy the product from the, or invest in the product pitched by the man than the woman. But if they were unattractive, it didn't matter quite as much. If they're attractive, the men get a boost and the women get a deficit. They get harmed by being too pretty in this situation. All right, leaders. When you ask what are the qualities of leadership, there's been lots of studies of this now, and they all show large effect sizes for the qualities. When you think of the word leader, we think of the qualities that are synonymous with masculinity, and we don't think of the qualities synonymous with femininity, so it becomes challenging for women. For, you know, when you're recruiting a leader, to picture that woman fulfilling this role. So, and again, both male and female judges have this same bias. So if you haven't done it, go to the Harvard Implicit website. You can test yourself on whether you think that males, whether you more easily associate male names with math and science, female names with arts and humanities. And there's other tests too. There's tests on racism, on ageism, on weightism. And by and large, we're all biased. Many more people, the vast majority of us, have strong to moderate associations with of family words with female names, or career words with male names. Same thing for humanities versus science. Much easier to associate male names with science and female names with humanities subjects than vice versa. So we've got these biases. So what? We don't act on these biases. Well, that's where the research has been most interesting. This huge database that the Harvard site makes available to researchers, you can actually look at whether the degrees of implicit bias correlate with anything. In this case, look, they correlated with the degree of math gap in the society. So each of these is a different country. And this is the TIMSS test. It's a test of eighth grade math achievement given around the world. And so countries where you have a larger implicit bias, where you associate male with STEM and female with liberal arts, you see the bigger gap in eighth graders, boys performing better than girls, and vice versa for less implicit bias. And so even at 7, 8 years of age, boys and girls already make this association. Boys and girls both believe that boys are better at reading, or boys are better at math, girls are better at reading. And this ironically happens even before there's any differences in achievement. So they've internalized the sex difference stereotype even before they've witnessed it in their own classroom. And so, or to put it in a more comic way, you know, two boys up at the chalkboard, wow, you suck at math. And then, of course, the girl has to become the exemplar. Wow, girls suck at math. And that's where stereotypes are born. So one more correlation in this case to show, this isn't with implicit bias, this just shows how culture impacts our thinking, our learning, our talents, our traits. So looking, each one of these is from a different country. This is a huge study. And the more women that are in research in that country, the lower the math gap until you get to a point of no math gap. If you're familiar with the PISA exam that's given to 15-year-olds around the world. So few women in research, big advantage to boys. Lots of women in research, no advantage to boys. So it's amazing how these role models really kick in. And of course, why does it matter? Because in every country of the world, women get paid less than men. This is equal. And here's the US. The average is 17%, or as I like to put it, women. All right, so I really am done. In summary, sex differences in brain and behavior are real but subtle. I hope I convinced you, with much more overlap than difference. And I'm sort of painting the glass half empty. Girls have made tremendous advances, which I think really proves the potency of plasticity. In 40 years, look at how many more women we've got. We whine about women in STEM, but every field of STEM has increased many-fold over that period. But we obviously have further to go. And today, I actually think that boys are the ones that are being hit with this hardwired stuff. They're not hardwired to read or talk or connect emotionally. And I wonder the degree to which that is impairing them. So I'll leave it there. I'm sorry to go on so long. Hopefully I left some time for questions with you.
All right, thank you. We passed out cards at the beginning of the lecture, so if you have written down a question, please pass them to the Magda over there who's waving her hands.
And you can pass them over here to
Our usher on this side of the room. Okay, I've got a few from the overflow room, so I'm going to start with one of these. Are you aware of any studies involving transsexuals and cognitive differences? Or brain differences.
Yeah. So, the transsexual literature hasn't caught up with the transsexual discussion or the number of transsexuals who are out now. And so there's a lot more literature, I would say, on homosexuals, gays and lesbians. And there certainly is a cognitive shift, so that if you look at things like spatial skills and verbal skills, a male homosexual tends to score somewhere in between a heterosexual female and a heterosexual male, and same thing for lesbians. But when people have tried to look at the brain differences, there's nothing that's really jumped out, except for when they've imaged brain activation during sexual arousal. And so in that case, just as you'd predict, a male homosexual brain activation would look like a female heterosexual when viewing male pornography and vice versa. So there's undoubtedly the behavioral changes are going to be reflected in the brain, but the brain research hasn't really caught up yet.
Yeah. Okay, here's another one. Why do you think that the books and the reporting that is not based on good research so popular? Why does it get promoted in the way that it does,
yeah,
as compared to the stuff that's based on the more...
So sex differences are sexy, that's all I can say. And if you've ever been to a frat party, I suspect you would see that in the way young adults dress and, We like our differences, they're fun, and somehow having a biological basis for it, neuroscience is sexy. So sex differences are sexy, brain science is sexy. You put the two together, it's kind of an irresistible combo, I guess.
Could you tell us what evidence-based, research-based, pre-kindergarten and kindergarten learning environment would look like, given what you've shown us, mm-hmm, about brain plasticity and the small differences?
Yeah. So, my colleagues and I, who are concerned about gender essentialism in the schools, don't seem to get as much opportunity to talk to the teachers as Leonard Sachs and Michael Gurian. I think that when I have spoken to teachers like at Waldorf and Montessori and some of the more you know, kind of progressive environments. You know, you just have to stop using the word boys and girls and lining them up separately and being comfortable when all the boys are clustered in the block corner and they shoo a girl away or you see kids separated out on the playground. I mean, they, you know, the notion is that they, that children segregate completely spontaneously, but we really do make it easy for them in the role models that they see and in the birthday parties we schedule. And I would just challenge teachers to break up these single gender clusters. Just like, you know, if you had a class with half African Americans and half Caucasian students and they never blended, you would be very uncomfortable with that. And I think we need to treat gender the same way, with an eye to the diversity and the mixed communities that we're all working and living in later in life.
This question is asking about, I think, how the implicit bias phenomenon gets projected into our perceptions about infants. Like, is there research where, regardless of the actual sex of the infant, if the observer perceives the infant to be male or female, does that change their perception of the infant?
Absolutely. Whoever wrote that question just designed an experiment. The experiment's been done, but it was very trendy for a while. People were doing these gender-neutral babies. I think the slide I showed of infants was supposed to be that where you dress babies up in white and where is that? Yeah, so this was from one of those studies where they take babies and they remove any gender cues and then give them any name you want. Give them John or Jane or whatever. And sure enough, you do find that parents will parents, even non-parents, adults who don't have kids or older children will, if the child is given a boy's name, they'll comment more on his physical strength and intelligence. And if it's a girl, they'll comment more on her physical beauty, pretty much. But we need more of this research. There hasn't been enough. And there is a sense that this has changed over the years. So if so, we want to document that. So any students out there, it's a good project.
Are there behavioral differences that we can see caused by hormonal effects in adulthood, whether that be hormone therapy or even menstruation?
That's a great question, too. And that's something I've spent a lot of time looking into. So we talk about hormones having effects at two phases of life. There's the prenatal hormones, the organizational phase, literally. Prenatal testosterone builds the male genitalia, and based on animal studies, it does seem to affect certain features of behavior like physical aggression. But then after birth, the hormone levels lie really low. We call it the juvenile pause. So estrogen, testosterone are indistinguishable between males and females between birth and puberty, which, you know, starts about 11 for girls, a little bit later for boys. And then the question is, what happens once, you know, girls start cycling and men reach their adult levels of testosterone? And there's been loads of research on this, and the data are all over the map. So if you want to find a study that shows that female cognitive skills fluctuate with the menstrual cycle, you can find it. And if you want to find a study that doesn't show it, you can find that too. I'm not aware of good meta-analyses on those. Same thing for testosterone. They've been studies of men who are, let's see, they take testosterone blockers, I think, for certain forms of prostate cancer, and they weren't, you know, one study found it affects their spatial skills, another did not. All over the map. So I don't believe that there's any substantial effect. There might be something really small you can pick up in a laboratory, but I don't think it's, as I write in my book, I don't think it's a reason for girls to postpone their geometry exam by 2 weeks because they're in the wrong phase of the cycle for doing their spatial skills.
Is there an effect that interacts with the sex and gender difference research of differences based on sexuality?
Well, I think I sort of referred to this before. So yeah, there's a lot of research on heterosexuals versus homosexuals in terms of both brain structure and function. And there's no gay brain, for example. I mean, there was this idea that, oh, you know, there's, in fact, yeah, there's this structure in the hypothalamus called the interstitial nucleus of the anterior hypothalamus number 3. There's 4 of them, but number 3 turned out to be the one that is different between males and females. It was found first in rats. It's about 5 times bigger in male rats compared to female rats. Prenatal testosterone is responsible for that difference. If you inject testosterone in a female before birth, this little nucleus grows to male size, and it may have something to do with sexual behavior. So it took researchers at 4 labs 20 years to agree on what was the equivalent of this in humans, and it's this tiny little nucleus. It's literally a tenth of a millimeter in diameter in the hypothalamus that is twice as large in human males and females. Well, Simon LeVay, probably 20 years ago, published a study looking at gay men and found that their interstitial nucleus was the same size as women, so they had a feminized, and that's the gay brain. Well, it didn't replicate. I think that was the first of many studies I found that got all this press and didn't replicate, and so there is no single marker for sexual orientation in the brain.
So this question may be a little far afield, but I think it's based in the implicit bias stuff that you talked about in the end. Is there a bias, an implicit bias in the way that doctors treat men and women? Mm-hmm. For example, do women get the it's all in your head sort of diagnosis more than men or anything like that?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, neurosis is a female disorder, so by and large, right? I mean, it was defined first in women. And we talked about this a little bit earlier today. There are many, many diseases that show different prevalence between men and women. Physical diseases and especially psychiatric diseases. So depression, anxiety, anorexia, much more common in women, more commonly diagnosed. Addiction, autism, ADHD, more common in males. The problem, I think, is that these medical students, because I teach medical students, there's a lot of memorization that goes into training a doctor, and they have so much to memorize, and it's easy to memorize these different prevalences. And then you have this shadow when somebody walks in your office and they're male or female, and you're looking for certain diseases in one sex more than another. And so for almost all of those diseases, there's pretty good evidence that depression is underdiagnosed in men, that it may be expressed more as irritability in men as opposed to sad affect, that ADHD is underdiagnosed in females relative to men. That's why adult women suddenly get diagnosed with ADHD. They didn't get diagnosed. And so on. Autism, too, is thought to be underdiagnosed in females. So I think it does cloud. Physicians are as biased as anybody when it comes to looking at their patients.
I think we're about out of time, and we're about out of questions. So please join me in thanking Dr. Eliot.